Our next speakers here this afternoon, please give a warm welcome to Ken and Carol Gillstrom.
Thank you. So today we're talking about darkness, evil in the dark, the joys of night boating. It's not just night sailing. This applies to power boats and sailboats. It's the darkness that we're going to be dealing with. My background, Sail Canada Advanced Cruising Instructor, RWA Yacht Master Offshore. I've got over 70,000 miles of experience on the water. 26,000 miles of that is on everybody else's boat, and 45,000 miles of that is on our custom designed built aluminum cutter designed by Ted Brewer. We built that in our backyard and have put 45,000 miles on it in the last 4 years. You say, why nights? That's when all the ghoulies come out. In the daytime, everybody's good. Well, the same happens out on the water, so why would I go out on the water? Really, night sailing or boating at night does a number of things for you. It will increase your cruising range. So instead of only being able to do daylight hours and maybe 8 to 10 daylight hours, middle of summer, maybe 12 or more, you're doing 5 knots. You know, you're pushing it, doing 60 nautical miles a day. And if you wanted to go cruising in the Thousand Islands, you've got probably 2 or 3 days to try to get there. But if you did one single overnight sail or power, you could be there in 28 to 30 hours and enjoy more time cruising the grounds that you really want to be cruising in. So it increases your cruising range by a long shot. You can take advantage of short weather windows. So whether it's a power or sailboat, you may be looking at, wow, there's a big high pressure over Lake Ontario. There's no waves out there. There's no wind. If you've got a power boat, that's the time you want to go. And it may only be available to you for a 24-hour period or 2-day period. So while you have those conditions, you like to put miles on. That's when we put our miles on. We're sailing, and if the wind is in the right direction, we put as many miles on as we can in the direction we want to go. And maybe on the way back, we'll be stopping in at the places that we skip by. But if you get out into the east or west coast, you've got tides and currents to deal with. Take advantage of a favorable tide or a favorable current. Currents in the Strait of Georgia off Vancouver, we're looking at 1.5 to 2 knots. And if you're trying to go north and the current is 1 knot, 2 knots against you, your boat does 6 knots. Now all of a sudden your speed over ground is 4 knots. Whereas if you can get a positive current working for you, your speed over ground is going to be 8 knots. So a big difference in the mileage that you can do and the ability to make landfall in daylight hours. So I've met a few people that are crossing from, I think it was Kingston, over to Oswego. It's a fairly long passage. I think it's 35 or 40 miles. And it's tight to do that in daylight hours. In September, you're down to shorter days. And to try to leave at sunrise and get into Oswego at sunset may be a bit of an issue. Whereas if you feel comfortable doing even a single overnight passage, you can leave Kingston in late afternoon in daylight and then be arriving at your destination in daylight hours. Boating at night can be just pure amazing. And it starts with beautiful sunsets. And as we see the sun go down, we are looking at it going down and we're saying, oh, it's going to be dark soon. So the stress level starts to rise in us and we start to try to deal with that. But one of our senses is gone, so we're trying to go through some tips today on helping you compensate for that. And then you've got these amazing full moons. You don't see the full moon like you do in the city. Full moons are quite spectacular. On our way back from Alaska 2 summers ago, we were looking for that weather window. We were up in Glacier Bay. And then we said, well, we're going to have a north wind for 2 or 3 days. We had 450 miles to go to back to Prince Rupert. We headed out and we had 3 nights in a row with the northern lights. And then in those conditions, you're looking up in the sky and it's just magical what you see. The northern lights up in Alaska on those clear nights were just spectacular. Out in the ocean, you've got these luminescent trails that follow you. The phytoplankton get excited by your boat going through the water, and they emit light. And well, it's interesting, if you're in your head and you flush the head at night, it excites them enough that the seawater you're bringing in is igniting the toilet and spinning around. But this is behind the boat, and your bow waves are creating these amazing luminescent trails. And just looking out and seeing that, it just blows your mind when you look at it. And then you've got the infinite stars, like the full moon, but these infinite stars, there's no other light pollution to get in the way. You see so many stars out there. I remember one night going across the Atlantic, I was looking up at the stars, and then all of a sudden, the whole sky turned into daylight. And it was some piece of space debris was coming back to Earth, and it nighted as it came through the atmosphere. And for 3 or 4 seconds, it was daylight, and then it went back to this spectacular sky. The other thing you've got is sea creatures. We've had a few issues with flying fish flying across and smashing into our heads or going into our cowl vents in the middle of the night. But going from Galapagos to Hawaii, we had 3 or 4 nights in a row where the water was very luminescent green, and it was photoplankton, but the squid, I guess, are feeding on them and emitting their own green. So as we were going along, they saw our green starboard nav light in the middle of the night, and all we saw were these squid jumping out of the water and trying to mate with our starboard light. In the morning, we would go and walk the deck, and we would have a dozen or two dozen squid on the deck that we were peeling off that had dried overnight. No, we didn't eat them. One night, we had a bird that flew into our wind generator and got knocked out into the water, but recovered enough to fly back onto the boat. He was standing on our lifelines for 2 days straight. So you think of a web foot trying to hold on to the little lifeline. You can see it there. And he's just going back and forth like that, trying to rest himself. He was an arm's length away from us in the cockpit. And so we're on watch by ourselves. Well, now we have a watchmate. This guy got more conversation out of us than anybody else on the boat. Then you've got the beautiful city landscapes. I know the city of Toronto looks spectacular. When you get out on the water and you see the city, it looks totally different. It's just amazing. This is downtown Vancouver. Here, I think we're anchored in False Creek a couple of months ago. But the city takes on this beautiful air to it. And finally, the sunrises are amazing. There's that 2 or 3 minutes when the sun is coming up where you've got to have your camera out. If you miss it, it's gone for another day. So you're waiting for that. You're taking your pictures. And then there's that sense of relief that you've made it through another night.